A year ago, President Trump announced that he was going to start a technical war against China. These are easy to win. The Wall Street Journal later said that Donald Trump is going to commit a great mistake in his administration, and that the great victims would be the exporting countries and the world economic growth in general. Was this a good idea, a bad idea? Let's analyze this today. This is a geopolitical battle behind this negotiation. We'll analyze current news too, and analysis, as always. There have been new steps in this new commercial war. There was a raise of tariff from 10 to 25% on thousands of other Chinese products. This would be like $250 billion. Beijing answered with a reciprocity. And they would also tax U.S. customs products. U.S. also added Huawei to a company with which the U.S. companies could not negotiate. What does this mean? Companies like Google could not be able to send the Android system for the Huawei telephones and would limit the applications. Huawei has trying to alleviate the worry of the customers, saying that they are totally sustainable. The U.S. says that Huawei steals information, technological information from the U.S. and that they're a spy on behalf of China and that this attempts against national security. This is also the reason why they're being persecuted. Is there a possibility to reach an agreement? There have been negotiations that have been being held in Washington and Beijing.
Aunque esta lista de entidades esta vez.
Our company will not be affected, but the U.S. companies will have to comply with the law. Therefore, with the list of entities, they have to comply with the law. The news media should understand that the companies share principles with us, and that we're all actors in the market.
Pero como pensamos que estaban
we think,
vestidos, no hicimos preparativos para
we
ellos.
Think that we were always ready for this. There may be some impact,
el campo más avanzado no se verá afectado.
But the most, the forefront of technology, 5G, will not be affected.
Otros no podrán ponerse al
and others won't be able to catch up with us in the next 2 or 3 years. Just recently, we have declared repeatedly the Chinese position to the abuse on behalf of the U.S.
Y reprimir voluntariamente a empresas de otros países,
to not let other companies of other worlds, of other countries, to negotiate with China. When it comes to China, we have always asked them to do operations in other countries, therefore complying with international law. Thus, we've asked other companies to offer the other companies a non-discrimination treatment with us. We're having a small dispute with China because we have been treated unfairly for many decades. The relationship I have with President Xi is extraordinary. It's really good. But he is for China, and I am in favor of the U.S. That's simple. Once again, we're in a strong position. They want to make a deal. Absolutely, that could happen. Yesterday, Huawei created a system that could substitute the Google software. This was part of the answer that Huawei gave to replace the Google
Y este sistema se llama, como lo vemos allí, entre
This system is called Hongmen, which is being developed from the year 2002. It will be able to use on personal computers, on tablets, and on phones.
Detallaba el representante, el alto ejecutivo de la empresa china, Richard Yu.
This is what Richard Yu, president of the company, said. He also added that the name is provisional and it may be substituted in the future. But the word Hongmen was chosen due to a hero of the Chinese tradition. Hispan TV says.
Disculpen, digo, OCDE urge a detener escalada de tensiones comerciales en
OCDE asks for to stop the escalation of the technological war. They say that in their semestral inform, the Organization for the Cooperation and Economical Development is asking for to overview this, and they think that the transactions between the U.S. and China may decrease. For the organization, this is grave. Before, the International Monetary Fund had made aware that the increase of taxes could reduce the economical growth in 2020. Another entity said that there could be a diminishing in the world economy. Let's see what Nodal says. These are news from Latin America and Caribbean of May 9th this year. Data, capitalism, and geopolitical. 5G. Do you know where Port Williams is? And what he says is, the 5G technology is becoming a vital important in the data capitalism. Well, it gives the conditions, the technological conditions, to keep on advancing in the new economy with the use of electronic money and robotics is at the forefront of technology. Whoever is able to develop it will have major capacity.
Especialmente por los trabajos en Puerto Williams para que sea el extremo sur de su infraestructura.
The U.S. is
y agrega el autor a modo de ejemplo
has a headquarters in Port Williams, which is in the far south of Chile.
Interconectados en 2021 se multiplicarían por 10 gracias a la tecnología.
Thanks to 5G, you could have more connection among many devices.
Pero el asunto es mucho más relevante.
But the problem is,
que nosotros veremos dónde ponemos nuestros datos.
Let's see where we put our information because of security. Let's take this to analyze. Let's talk to Jorge Gestoso from Washington, D.C. Give us more information, please.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much.
Debemos ver en el contexto que está ocurriendo.
We should see this in the full context of this commercial war between the U.S. and China. President Trump directly has begun the re-election campaign. And this fits perfectly in his strategic plan. What he is trying to create is the illusion that the U.S. is a victim and that this being abused by another country, another economic system, among those China. So what they're trying to do is to save the American people from this abuse.
How does
he want to do it? By sanctioning China by using taxes. What he says is that China is exporting to the U.S. with no tariffs. And China does not pay intellectual property rights. And this is one of the major criticisms. So what he's saying is that he's trying to level the plane and therefore creating jobs for the American people. What is the other side of the coin? This is not working for him, because definitely the Chinese have already started to counterattack, and what they're doing is putting tariffs on the agricultural products. And this is also very important for the agricultural workers in the U.S. because China is not worried, is not buying soy from the U.S. and they are not able to start waiting for this situation to solve. So Trump is losing votes, and in this context he's going to have to readjust his philosophy of trying to play as a hard man. He will have to stop his intentions. His only interest is to increase his voter base. Let's go back to you. Thank you, Jorge. So now we ask ourselves, do you think that Trump is going to be able to go in reverse? There's a lot of interest in both powers to attain the 5G technology. What will this mean for everybody? We're going to ask our analysts who are ready, and we will be with them after the first pause. We ask ourselves, this geopolitical war behind the technological war, are they both interrelated? Well, we're also saying is the 5G technology will allow people to do what? Why is it so important? Let's see two websites. The first one is spanish.china.org.cn. What they're saying is that there could be a long-distance brain surgery with the help of 5G. And China is practicing doing this. Past May 16th, a patient with Parkinson was the first patient to be operated with technology 5G through the Huawei platform. The doctors made an implant in the brain that did not cure completely the sickness, but did help. It was a surgery of over 3 hours, and the patient was in Beijing and could not travel to the place where the surgery was supposed to be held. It was basically 3,000 of distance, and the computer was connected to a 5G network. This is a land point in technology and in medicine. There had also been a liver transplant, also directly connected with streaming with high definition images. All of this thanks to the 5G technology. Okay, this is a first approximation. Let's go to another one. It's in Russia Today. Trump, I want 5G and even 6G in the U.S. as soon as possible.
De las ventajas, de la funcionalidad.
Well, we've already seen the advantages. What he literally said through Trump was, I want 5G and even 6G technology in the United States as soon as possible. It is far more powerful, faster, and smarter than the current standard. American companies must step up their efforts or get left behind. There is no reason why we should be lagged behind on.
La verdad es que la tecnología de transmisión de datos 5G en Estados Unidos.
The truth is that 5G in the United States still needs more investment. And
está disponible solo en Chicago y en Minneapolis.
Right now we can only have access to it in Chicago and Minneapolis.
No podemos permitir.
And what he says is that we cannot let any other country go ahead of the U.S.
Debe ganarle a Estados Unidos y para ello.
He wants the U.S. to win this war.
Tienen el incentivo que necesitan.
And now the companies that are involved have already received support from the U.S. government.
Bueno, sigamos descifrando.
Let's keep on deciphering this geopolitical war, which is behind the technological war. China has begun to revolutionize the world with the 5G technology, not only in cell phone communication, but also in all type of networks. What they're going to attain is going to have a larger base of users for 2019. They're aspiring to collect $58 billion with the network of 5G.
Se estima que para 2025,
it is approximated by 2020,
a más de la mitad del planeta.
This network will connect over half of the world. That means 500 million users will be connected. This means that they will always be connected and always have access to their data. The first country to do this was China. China and the U.S. are the two powers who dominate the technological field. And little by little, you can see that Europe is getting behind. Huawei is the strong Chinese powerful company that is the first provider of telecommunication devices. And there's a consensus that these devices might be the cheapest one. But this is far more important. There's a technological war. The U.S. says that China has put into place spies and non-legitimate actions. On the other hand, China has also set tariffs on the U.S. products that will be in place from June. This was set in place just 24 hours after the U.S. duplicated the tariffs on China products.
Ya nos esperan para intercambiar en este.
Okay, we're ready to talk to our guests. We will analyze how both countries have mutually imposed tariffs on each other.
Desde Caracas, Sergio Rodríguez.
Let's talk with Sergio Rodríguez from Caracas.
Y desde Buenos Aires, Ernesto Matos, economista.
And Ernesto Matos from Argentina. We greet you both.
Sergio, comienzo con usted desde Caracas, Venezuela. Ernesto, espéranos solo unos segundos. Le pregunto, Sergio,
Sergio,
si estamos ya claramente ante una guerra.
Are we clearly in front of a war?
Sí, claro, así.
Yes,
lo,
of course.
Así lo han, así
this
lo
is
han
how
definido,
it has been defined.
Chino, en concreto,
by Chinese analysts.
El periódico Global Times.
And specifically, the Global Times newspaper has announced that this situation is already, can already be called a confrontation. And if it might not be a military war, because in this century, we do not have military wars, but we have hybrid wars. This means economic, commercial wars.
Esto lo que oculta es
But in fact,
que el elemento fundamental de la confrontación
we can say that
es
the main
tecnológico,
element of the confrontation
porque,
is technological.
Para una potencia serlo,
because
necesita tener
a powerful country to be so, they must be first in the military standpoint and also in the technological standpoint.
Estados Unidos sigue teniendo
well, militarily, the U.S.
una superioridad indudable
is still superior
China, pero lo curioso
in
este
respect
caso,
to China.
No se plantea superar a Estados Unidos
but, well, but China isn't trying
su presupuesto
to exceed
militar sigue siendo
the military force of the U.S. Their budget is one-fifth of their
pero
budget.
En el terreno económico,
but economically,
hay algunos índices,
there are some indexes that express that China is
mundial,
now the first economical power of the world. Analysts even say
argentino que es economista lo podrá explicar mucho mejor que yo. Se supone que en el año 2045
they say that in the year 2045
China va a igualar a Estados Unidos en el
China
bruto per cápita
will have the same GDP as the US.
El primer centenario de la República Popular China cuando ellos se han planteado
and that will be that will coincide with the 100 years of the Chinese Republic.
Dejarán de ser un país
and by then,
medio para ser un país
they want to be a country, they do not want to be a country of medium development, but of first type development.
Por la primacía es en el aspecto
and
de
another
la
aspect
y donde precisamente
is technology,
la inauguración del año 2019
where
trajo
with the beginning of the year
2019,
China
una nave espacial
was able
en
to
la cara
set
oculta de la luna, lo cual nunca antes se había logrado.
Set a satellite on the,
también, entonces,
on the one side of the moon.
Todo esto que te ha explicado anteriormente y que se ha dicho anteriormente con
and everything that has said, been said before about the 5G technology
en tanto se aplique con criterio humanitario, con criterio
as long
de
as,
científico y
as long as it's applied for humanitarian development to improve the conditions of life
no
of the people
guerra,
and not for the war and conflict,
entonces,
it's viable. So we're confronted with a situation that what is in game
is that
is a total control of the U.S. to impose their principles and on the other hand,
the
Chinese, Chinese aims that they want to use the 5G technology to use it for humanitarian use, such as medicine. There are many other fields where the 5G technology may help. If we see it in these terms, we're obviously confronted with a war. When you read the Chinese newspapers and the Chinese analysts, I was recently in China. I just arrived yesterday, and I spoke with Chinese colleagues, and they say that this conflict
Sergio, por
is a war.
Conceptualización y
thank you very much, Sergio, for this first
ahora ir a Buenos Aires,
opinion. Let's go to Buenos Aires.
Como ya referíamos, Ernesto, bienvenido.
Ernesto will be having an opinion.
Ciencia, economía y geopolítica.
We're combining science,
de poder pareciera,
politics,
en lo económico, ser,
and geopolitical.
A esta andanada de aranceles que se ha lanzado de un
what
lado
can we say about
quien pierde,
this counterattack of taxes between the U.S. and China?
De seguir adelante con una guerra, con una confrontación de esta naturaleza.
Bueno, Estados Unidos,
well, the U.S. has a prepared bureaucracy. As soon as Donald Trump sends a measure of internal security, when confronted with the fact that China will use 5G,
sería el responsable de telecomunicaciones de Estados Unidos también celebraba la medida.
Then all of the United States support Donald Trump and these tariffs. And they have a double standard because if it's not a field where they're the leaders, And as soon as they have a competitor, the U.S. will display all of their bureaucracy and set tariffs on everything that has to do with importations on technological products.
Viene a mostrar también en muchos casos y como se cree económicamente en la región que un estado chico nos va a llevar al desarrollo y la realidad que
well, truth
se
is,
está evidenciando con esta guerra comercial
is that with this war you can see that on the one hand China has a bourgeoisie that's totally disciplined
y Estados Unidos
and the U.S. has a bourgeoisie that is based on capitalism.
Se hizo una jugada al revés al fracaso de Donald Trump de la medida de las tarifas porque el déficit comercial entre 2000
that just shoot himself on the foot with the tariff imposition.
Millones de dólares. Donald Trump no tuvo éxito con la medida.
Donald Trump before had tried this and had no success with it.
Adelantaron importaciones.
It's because some of these U.S. companies already had importations in advance.
Los sectores privados en cada una de las potencias.
This tells you, this puts a light on how the companies on both countries are confronting the upcoming measures. We must take in mind that APEC had its meeting where China had already asked freedom of commerce among the member countries. And this discussion became relevant in the 2018-2019 APEC meeting. Well, the U.S. did not discuss in APEC their policies, but they did it bilaterally with each country. And would China ask for free commerce?
Que la cumpliría también en estos años. Entonces,
so,
sigue avanzando,
China is still advancing,
paso a paso,
step by step, and imposing itself, and this obviously generates a lot of noise in the White House.
Ernesto,
this could not stop. What is the worst consequence in economical terms that this may cause?
Domésticas e internacionales y, e incluso es una alerta que leíamos así el Fondo Monetario Internacional. Fin de la globalización, fin del libre mercado, muy lejos de eso, repercusiones.
No, bueno, salvo en el producto well, soja que favorece hoy a Argentina y Brasil.
The only product that Brazil and Argentina
su diplomacia para
is
más
favored
soja,
by the soy, but the soy.
Farmers norteamericanos a los cuales tuvo que transferir subsidios económicos.
But there have been
no estaban vendiendo.
There have been some other examples where the U.S. has had to change their policies. Because the European Union is also a dispute. But beyond all this, I think this is a period similar to the Cold War. Because the countries that are not so economically important could decide from to one country to another faced with this situation. So it might be an opportunity to display policies that may develop while the two powerful countries maintain this dispute.
Pivotear como históricamente se hizo cuando uno tiene una neutralidad.
And if Latin America stays neutral, like Argentina, this happened when, in the past, when there have been disputes. So I think it's an opportunity for the poorer countries to display their national policy. Then it will depend on each country what type of policies they put forth. Let's go back to Sergio.
Sumado a otros golpes que propina Estados Unidos en simultáneo y en varios
added to another to all of the policies that the U.S. is putting out, do you think this might be enough to get rid of China?
Bueno,
well,
Yo creo que la pregunta del momento
I think
es
that the
si todo lo que
question right now
mundo,
is if everything that's happening in the world right now, this commercial
la
war,
la situación de extrema tensión en el
extreme
Golfo
tension
Pérsico,
in the Persian Gulf, aggression against Venezuela,
Corea,
paralyzing the negotiation in Korea, more genocide in Yemen,
conflictividad interna,
internal conflict.
De los migrantes en Europa,
and with
etcétera,
the migrants
etcétera, etcétera.
In Europe, etc.
And
all of these threats,
un cuadro de amenazas,
all of these threats, well, there's so many that I'm even making a chart of them.
¿Quién le toca ser amenazado cada día?
So every day there's somebody else, somebody new who's being threatened on behalf of Trump. He's threatening somebody every day, a company or a government.
Todo este clima de tensión,
so
este
all
clima
of this
de amenaza,
tension,
de ataque, de presión, de posibilidad de la guerra,
and possibility of war.
Creo que la pregunta fundamental,
the question, the fundamental question is,
si esto lo hace Estados Unidos,
does the U.S. do this?
Está en una situación
because
de fortaleza extrema,
they're extremely strong,
que permite que haga esto,
that allows them to do this,
por el
or on the contrary, if this is
porque está en una situación de debilidad.
This is happens because they're extremely weak. So they're acting like a wounded animal who's just attacking.
Sale maltrecho. Creo que la respuesta a esa pregunta,
well, I think the answer can give us light on what you have just asked, in the sense that if we accept that the answer is the first, this means that
we're
constantly under threat. This is a situation, this is very negative. This might, this will point to the destruction of the social movements that are constantly protesting. In general, there is a grand mobilization. But if the answer is a second, in the sense that the U.S. is extremely weak, and today it has its most clear and pure expression through this technological war, what we have to understand
as this
is a crisis of capitalism. This is their clear expression.
Pero sí que
I'm not saying that it's reaching the last days, but it's a manifestation
crisis,
of elements of this crisis
imperial,
in this imperialistic
Unidos,
phase.
Y que eso en lugar que
and in the first place, this Unidos has caused for the U.S. establishment bring somebody like Trump. Because in the bipartisan structure and in the general political scheme, they did not find a solution to a crisis that, according to the economical analysts, like Professor Ugarteche and Professor Armando, I forgot his last name, they say that it supports with concrete numbers that the crisis in the U.S. comes from the 80s, and that in this 40-year period there has been a globalization
de la producción,
and this has made that the U.S. have low production, that they don't produce anything, and that's why their economic deficit are growing. So this is a crisis situation. And President Trump, that is a company man, and that every day he checks his numbers, and they're red all the time, he uses lies to support his actions. And now he's looking for answers to get him reelected as president for the year 2020. So we must analyze the situation in global terms and understand that we're assisting to a situation of profound crisis
Unidos,
in the U.S.
in structural terms,
and that this commercial war that is undergoing with China is just to try to save the U.S. from a conflictive economical situation. Because on one side, the capital has replaced the productive capital,
and
the U.S. economy is just an economy of services and not of production, and that's why it needs from the importation and the production of other countries. I'll just give you one piece of numbers. Yesterday there was a press conference about with Nike, Puma, and Adidas, who asked President Trump to please not apply the tariffs to the shoe production. And they gave him a number, 72% of shoes that U.S. that the use comes from China. This means that there would be an increase in footwear in around $25 billion increase of prices to the U.S. people because of this commercial war. There are far more reserves in China than the U.S. This is because,
como dije, vengo llegando de China y allá uno no observa que allá
in China,
una preocupación extrema.
You do not see an extreme worry.
Esta guerra comercial.
On the contrary, they consider this commercial war is an opportunity to increase their technological
el año pasado
base.
Last year,
Huawei invested $15 billion in technological development, and there's no other company who has done the same. And in this sense, what they're doing is speeding up the plans they had for the next years. They're just speeding up to solve the problems that this situation is generating.
Al problema que ha copado, digamos, los periódicos, los
this worldwide problem that has been that has been shown through many
Google,
many newspapers in the world. And what we see is that there is an alternative. They have an alternative. Chinese always think in the future. As we heard, the presidents of Huawei said that nobody can catch up to us in a 2 or 3 year period. I'm sorry, we ran out of time. We have many other programs about this, and we will be able to have more exchanges. Thank you very much for your participation. Let's have some conclusions. Sergio says this is part of the capitalist crisis. Let's keep on answering questions. Even if the conflict is not that clear, there is a battle, a bilateral battle. But let's see this in a global context. It's true, it's a conflict between the U.S. and China, but they will have effects on many other countries, either because it's their neighbors or their strategic allies, or they depend on one of these two countries. This battle between China and the U.S. that was initiated by Donald Trump affects Mexico and Canada. They have even gone to international tribunals to try to solve this issue. They both have tariffs on aluminum and steel. In reciprocity, they also applied tariffs. Latin America, who has risks and opportunities, most of the Latin American countries want to continue negotiating. It's not very sure how this part of the hemisphere will fare out. It's important to know that the Latin America has cheap handwork and provide most of the basic resources. European Union, this puts them in a hard, between a rock and a hard place. Trump threats the European bloc, because there is a strong political influence. The European cells have duplicated. Specifically, Spain is in problems. We have, because the U.S. is the sixth commercial ally, and China is the
10th.
Black olives is one of the products that has tariffs in the U.S. with a 34% tariff of entry to the U.S. Finally, what will Europe do when confronted with these repetitive attacks on trying to persuade them towards his interests? We will analyze in the next block. Is this a bilateral war or multilateral war? We will talk with the next guest right after our last pause. Please stay with us. We're back. Let's analyze this geopolitical war. This is the doctrine that's behind. For the U.S., the commercial war is in their actions of American First. That started in his electoral campaign. He combines this idea that their economic allies have taken advantage of the U.S., and that this is why the U.S. has problems now producing. And along with his promise to being the president who has more workplace has opened, he thinks that there has to be more protection on the U.S. factories and companies and stop these companies that leave to other countries to make cheaper products. He's saying that the free trade agreements installed by Obama have threatened the American economy. Then the NAFTA has also been criticized by him. So he had to open negotiations to reanalyze them. Counselors to Trump think that it's important to reanalyze the American structure that has been affected by free trade agreements. Edgardo Ramírez is our sociologist and a scholar of the university.
¿Cómo está? Gracias a usted,
Professor Edgardo. Welcome. Let's talk about the ideas. Is this a multilateral war of many fronts? Yes, and it's been growing since the year 2008 when the U.S. begins a recession. And it's from 2009 when China, as an economic potential, has a great economic growth. They had a great impact with the 30% of growth of all of the world. So China saw an opportunity. So what is the opportunity? China's economy has a different structure as the American, because the government has a strong role, and China has also prioritized the investment in technology. So socialist, in this context, for the good of humanity, is giving more investment
Ese hecho
to this area.
Es un elemento puntual del tema de la multilateral. Del multilateralismo.
So we can say it's a multilateral war because the commercial routes to China
es una alternativa
para el mundo, para la humanidad.
Has 70 routes. And these 70 countries represent 45% of the GDP of the entire world.
El ordenamiento de la economía por la vía del comercio.
So the commercial aspect is taking over the world, not necessarily by war, by a military war, but it's taking over in a commercial sense.
Con los gastos de guerra. Para este año estamos hablando de un presupuesto de más de 700 mil millones de dólares, que ellos llaman de defensa. Pero este
they have a very high budget for defense. So it's important to be clear that the Communistic Party is conquering the world based on their technological development. So this is a scientific war, an economical war, but overall it's scientific, because this is when it's going to determine the geopolitical outcome. And in this context, the Chinese president has even changed the constitution to allow Xi Jinping to continue being president. This is an essential element that talks about the trust the Communist Party is transmitting to the people. So yes, there is an ideological dispute in the world. When it was said that the Marx principles were dead, it turns out that China, in their own special way, is at war with capitalism and is creating more benefits to humanity. The only country in the world that has a major capability than the U.S. is China. There is no other. And in fact, I repeat that for science and technology, we're speaking with Huawei as a great company, but of the 10 main companies, there are four of them are Chinese. First one is Huawei, third one is uSilicon, and the first American is Qualcomm, is number 5 in the world. So in all economical scenario, China is exceeding the U.S. in economical terms. But yeah, let's say the U.S. is the first economy in the world. We have to check it out. We have 3 illicit activities: paradises, war, and drug dealing. These are aspects that do not affect China. They don't have that income.
So
this war goes beyond the economical balance, but it will determine the future of the rest of the world. China is betting on science and technology in favor of humanity. Thank you very much, Professor. Let's go to our conclusions. Well, this is clearly a war with very harsh effects. This is their basis, science and technology. There is a competition for being the leader in the world.
quien lanzó la primera piedra.
The US threw the first rock.
Nos decía Sergio, tiene una fortaleza extrema.
We can say that he has an extreme strength.
En una situación de debilidad y actúa.
Or on the other hand, do you think it's he's being threatened? The upcoming 2020 elections, Trump is looking for re-election. Will this increase his voter base or reduce it? For China, it's a moment of opportunities to expand their technology, in which they already have great work done. This is the end of Jugada Crítica. Thank you very much for being with us. Thank you very much. Goodbye.